Krishnarao College of Engineering and Technology. 2008 lo sthapinchina kalasalalo MBA, NAC A grade mariyu ISO certification sadinchina motta modati kalasala Sri Muthuvarpu Venkateswarao College of Engineering and Technology. Twaralo autonomous kabothundi.
2014 lo ISO gurtimpu, 2015 lo rashtra prabhutvache A grade, 2016 lo NAC A grade. Ippudu MBA sadinchina samstha Sri Muthuvarpu Venkateswarao College of Engineering and Technology.
Morning. Here we are continuing the signals and vectors. So we already discussed in our last class signal. What is the analogy between signals and vectors? As we already know that signal is nothing but it is a function of one or more independent variables which consists some information. Okay, vector. What is vector? Vector is one which has both magnitude and direction. So here we are going to see the analogy between signals and vectors. What is meant by analogy? Analogy is nothing but similarity between signals and vectors. So a vector can be represented as a sum of its components. So it can be represented as a sum of its components. It has both magnitude as well as direction. A signal can also be represented as a sum of its components. So signal can be represented as a combination of it is a function of one or more independent variables. So which has some information. So next, coming to the component of a vector, what is meant by component of a vector? So here one vector, suppose if we take two vectors or two signals, v1 and v2 are two vectors, say. So component of v1, component of a vector means here we are going to represent the component of v1 in terms of v2. So component of one vector along with another vector, that is nothing but component of one vector along with another vector, that is v1 along v2. So a vector is represented by boldface style, specified by its magnitude and its direction, as we already discussed. So a vector is having both magnitude as well as direction. For example, here we are taking two vectors x and g, vector x of magnitude mod x and vector g of magnitude mod g. Okay, let the component of vector g along x. So let the component of vector g along another vector x. So it can be represented by cx, c into x. So g is approximately equal to cx. We can say that we can represent the vector g along with another vector x as cx. So geometrically, this component is the projection of g on x. The component can be obtained by drawing a perpendicular from the tip of g. So it is a g line. So from the tip of g we can draw, the component perpendicular to g. So perpendicular from the tip of g on x, so then cx will be formed. So here g and cx, g is the one vector and cx, what is cx? X is another vector. We can represent component of g along another vector x as g is equal to cx plus what is this e? This e is nothing but error vector. E is error vector. So from the tip of g, we can draw the perpendicular line towards the x-axis. So it cuts the x-axis at here. So this direction can be represented as cx and this direction can be represented as g. So g and cx are perpendicular to, we can say that these two are perpendicular to each other. So the component can be obtained by drawing a perpendicular from the tip of g on x and expresses as g equal to cx plus E, where E is nothing but error vector. E is nothing but error vector. Next, coming to the component of a vector. Component of a vector, there are infinite ways to express g in terms of x. We can express the vector g in terms of x. So there are a very large number of ways to express the component of one vector along another vector. So here we are taking two vectors g and x. So how to represent g and x component of g along with another vector x, g equal to cx simply. So like this, we have several ways to represent the component of vector g along the another vector x. So here we are taking two examples. These two are the two ways. There are infinite ways, but here we are taking two ways. This is one way and this is another way. So g and x1 can be represented like this. G and x1 can be represented like this. So g x1, that is cx1, and e1 is error vector. So g can be represented as c into x1 plus e1. Similarly, g can be represented here as c into x2 plus e2, where e1 and e2, these two are error vectors. Here e1 is an error vector in this function, e2 is error vector in this function. Okay. So this is error vector, e1 is error vector, e2 is error vector here. So here g is represented in terms of x plus another vector, which is called the error vector e. If we approximate g by cx, then g is approximately equal to cx. Okay, g is approximately equal to cx. So here g is approximately equal to cx. So g is approximated as cx here. Next, g is approximately equal to cx. The error in this approximation is the vector e. So e is represented as, this is the error vector. So from the above expression, see g equal to cx plus e, e can be extracted as g minus cx, is it not? So e is called error vector. So e equal to g minus cx, g minus cx. So like this, we can express e equal to g minus cx. So the error vector e equal to g minus cx. The error in the approximation in both cases for last figures are e1 from the first figure, e1 equal to g minus cx1 and e2 equal to g minus cx2. This is the error vector. These two are the error vectors in the above two figures. So error vector e1 is represented as g minus cx1 and error vector e2 is represented as g minus cx2. Next, we can mathematically define the component of vector g along x. How to define mathematically? We take the dot product. It is also called as inner or scalar product. So inner or scalar of two vectors g and x as g dot x is equal to magnitude of g into magnitude of x into cos theta. Okay, the dot product can be represented, mathematically represented like this. G dot x is equal to mod g into mod x into cos theta. The length of vector by definition is, what is the length of the vector? How it is defined? So by definition, it is defined as mod x square is equal to x dot x. The length of component of g along x is equal to, the length of component of g along x is nothing but g equal to c into x. So c into mod x. So c into mod x is nothing but mod g into cos theta. Mod g into cos theta. So multiplying both sides by mod x here. So c into mod x is equal to g into cos theta into mod x. That is g into mod g into mod x into cos theta. But mod g into mod x into cos theta is nothing but dot product of g into x. So c into mod x square is equal to g dot x, or c can be extracted as g dot x by x square or x dot x. So it is equal to 1 by mod x square into g dot x. Next, component of vector continuation. Consider the first figure again and expression for c. So consider these two cases. So this is the first figure. So this is the component of g along another vector x, that is from the tip of g we can draw the line which cuts the x-axis set here. So it will represent cx and it will represent g, and this is represented by e, this is error vector, okay, and this is the expression for c equal to g dot x by x dot x, or it is equal to 1 by mod x square into g dot x. Let g and x are perpendicular. Perpendicular means that is nothing but orthogonality condition. So here g and x are perpendicular to each other. So that is nothing but the orthogonality condition. So g has a zero component along x. G has a zero component along x. Here what we have to say is if g and x are perpendicular to each other, we can say that g has zero component along x axis. So if x is zero means g into zero, that is zero. So c gives zero, c equal to zero. G has zero component along x axis, or g is approximately equal to cx, is it not? So g has zero component, a component along x axis, a component of one vector along another vector is g equal to cx. If these two are perpendicular to each other, there is no component along x axis, that is nothing but that was zero, then c is equated to zero. Okay, from the equation g and x are orthogonal, if the inner product of two vectors is zero, that is g into x equal to zero, g has no component along x axis, so g dot x equal to zero, so that c becomes zero. Okay, so vector component and orthogonality can be extended to signals also. So this is the component of one. So earlier we have discussed about the component of one vector along another vector and orthogonality of vectors. So the same concept can be extended to the signals also. That means that component of one signal along another signal, similarly orthogonality of the two signals. Consider the approximating real signal g of t in terms of another real signal x of t. Whereas in the earlier case, we have taken the two vectors g and x. G is approximated x as g is approximately equal to cx. Like this, like that, here the same concept is extended to signals also. So g of t can be approximately equal to c into x of t with the limits t1 and t2, where t is in between t1 and t2. The error e of t in the approximation is given by. So here g of t is approximated as c into x of t plus e of t is also there. So e of t is error signal. So how to extract this error signal? E of t equal g of t minus c into x of t if t is in between t1 and t2, or it is zero otherwise. So the same concept is extended to signals also. This is the expression of component of one signal along another signal. Component of one signal along another signal. Okay, so component of a signal. As energy is one possible measure of signal size, to minimize the effect of error signal, we need to minimize its size. We have to minimize its size. The error energy is one possible measure of signal size. So energy signal can be, here it can be minimized. How to minimize this over the interval t1, t2? So integrating the error signal, so for minimizing the error signal, we have to integrate the square of the mean square of the function, e square of t dt, integral t1 to t2, e square of t dt. E square, e is nothing, e of t is nothing but g of t minus c into x of t. So integral t1 to t2, g of t minus c into x of t whole square into dt. For some choice of the energy is minimum, here we have to take the condition t, that is differentiate the error function dE with respect to c, and which is equated to zero, so that we will get the expression for c. So for some choice of c, the energy is minimum, so the necessary condition is d by dc of ee is equated to zero. What is ee here? E is nothing but integral t1 to t2 g of t minus c into x of t whole square dt. is the square function. So we have to differentiate this one with respect to c, and which is equated to 0. Okay, this is the necessary condition for minimizing the energy. So d by dc of integral t1 t to g of t minus c into x of t whole square dt, which is equated to 0. So extracting this, this is in the form of a minus b whole square, a square plus b square minus 2ab. So by extracting this, it will become d by dc of integral t1 t to g square t dt minus d by dc of 2c into integral t1 t to g of t x of t dt plus d by dc of c square into integral t1 to t2 x square t dt, which is equated to 0. Here there is no c term, so it will become 0. Here c term is there, so we differentiate this one. Here also t term is there, 2c. D by dc of c square is 2c. So here d by dc of t2c is 2. Okay, so by simplifying this one, we will get the expression as minus 2 into integral t1 to t2 g of t x of t dt plus 2c into integral t1 to t2 x square t dt, which is equated to 0. So from the above expression, we can extract c as integral t1 to t2 g of t x of t dt by integral t1 to t2 x square t dt. So it is the this is the expression for c, or c equal to 1 by ex. Ex is nothing but integral t1 to t2 x square t dt, as we already know about ex. So this is integral t1 to t e square t dt is nothing but ee. So here that x square t dt is nothing but ex. So 1 by ex into integral t1 to t g of t x of t dt. Okay, from the expression of the c in the vectors, so that is c equal to g dot x by x dot x, or 1 by mod x square into g dot x. It is also looking same as that of the expression for the two vectors. So expression for the c in vectors is 1 by mod x square into g dot x, whereas the expression for c in signals is 1 by ex into integral t1 to t2 g of t x of t dt. So there is a remarkable similarity between behavior of vectors and signals. Area under the product of two signals corresponds to the dot product of two vectors, g dot x. Okay, g dot x, it corresponds to integral t1 to t2 g of t into x of t dt. The energy of the signal is the inner product of signal with itself and corresponds to the vector length squared, which is the inner product of the vector with itself. Okay, so there is a similarity between dot product and integral t1 to t2 g of t into x of t dt. So consider the signal equation again, that is c equal to 1 by ex integral t1 to t2 g of t x of t dt. Signal g of t contains a component c into x of t. C into x of t is the projection of g of t on x of t. If c into x of t is 0, then c equal to 0. Signal g of t and x of t orthogonal over the interval t1 to t2. If these two signals are orthogonal over the interval t1 to t2, then g of t has no component along the signal x of t. So here we are taking two vectors. If these two signals are orthogonal to each other, then we can say that g of t, the signal g of t has no component along another signal x of t, like vectors. In vectors also, if the two vectors are orthogonal to each other, then we can say that the component of g has no component along the another vector x. So in that condition also, c becomes 0. C into x is equal to 0, or c equal to 0, or g dot x is equal to 0. C becomes 0. Here also, c into x of t is equal to 0, or c equal to 0. Signals g of t and x of t are orthogonal to each other over the interval t1 to t2. Let us consider the example for a square signal g of t. find the component of g of t of the form sin t, or in other words, approximate g of t in terms of sin t. So g of t, how to approximate g of t, the signal g of t in terms of another signal here, the signal given is a sin t is one signal, g of t is another signal. How to approximate g of t by sin t, that is c into sin t. So g equal to g of t is approximately equal to c into sin t over the interval 0 to 2 pi, g of t equals c into sin t. So x of t, let us take x of t is sin t, and error function e of x equal to integral 0 to 2 pi sin square t dt. By simplifying this, so we will get pi. From the equation of signals, what is the expression for the equation of signals? C equal to 1 by ex into integral t1 to t2 g of t into x of t dt. Okay, but ex is pi. As we already calculated, ex equal to pi. So substitute the value of ex in this expression so that c becomes 1 by pi into integral 0 to 2 pi g of t into x of t sin t dt. By simplifying this, we can get 1 by pi into integral 0 to pi sin t dt plus integral pi to 2 pi minus sin t dt. From the this we can obtain from the diagram. So here 0 to pi, pi to 2 pi. So from 0 to pi, the function is sin t dt. From pi to 2 pi, the function is minus sin t dt. So by simplifying this one, we will get the value of c is 4 by pi. So how to approximate g of t by sin t? G of t is approximately equal to c into sin t. The value of c is calculated as 4 by pi, so that g of t is approximated as 4 by pi into sin t. Okay, for the complex function, so here up to now we will discuss about the orthogonality of signals, analogy of signals and vectors. So component of one vector along another vector, component of one signal along another signal, and orthogonality of the signals and orthogonality of the vectors. Now we are going to see the orthogonality in complex signals. So for complex functions of t over an interval t1 is less than or equal to t is less than or equal to t2, that is initial condition, that is g of t is approximated as x of t, as g of t is approximately equal to c into x of t. Okay, so ex is nothing but ex equal to, it is the error function, that is integral t1 to t. This is, we are discussing about the signals, why it is represented as g of t, x of t, etc. If it is vector, it is represented as g only, it is represented as x only. Okay, so if it is the signal, that's why we can express it like this. So ex, the error signal ex, is equal to integral t1 to t2 mod of x of t whole square dt. The coefficient c and the error in this case is e of t equal to g of t minus c into x of t, is it not? So ee in the case of signals is equal to integral t1 to t2 mod of g of t minus c into x of t whole square dt. Okay, so ee equal to integral t1 to t2 g of t minus c into x of t whole square dt. So we know that mod u plus v whole square formula, that is u plus v into u star plus v star. Okay, so this is nothing but the representation of complex signals. So this is u square mod u square. The, by simplifying this one, we will get mod u square into v square plus u star into v plus u into v star. U into u star value is nothing but u into u star. Similarly, v into v star is 0. So u into u star plus u into v star plus v into u star plus v into v star. Okay, u into u star is represented by u square, v into v star is represented by v square here. Okay, so ee E can be obtained as integral t1 to t2 g of t whole square. It is looking like a minus b whole square or a plus b whole square. It can be expressed like this. Okay, u plus v into u star plus v star. Here also we represent this one like this. So we'll get the expression like this. E can be represented like this. So c equal to 1 by ex and integral t1 t to g of t into x star of t dt. By simplifying this one, we'll get the expression like this. So two complex functions are orthogonal over an interval if integral t1 to t2 x1 of t into x2 star t dt is equal to 0, or integral t1 to t2 x1 star of t into x2 of t dt is equal to 0. Okay, this is the orthogonality in complex signals. Okay, we can express the orthogonality conditions in orthogonality condition in complex signals like this. Integral t1 t to x1 of t into x2 star t dt is equal to 0, or integral t1 to t2 x1 star t into x2 of t dt equal to 0. So okay, for ordinary signals, what is the orthogonality condition of two signals? Suppose x1 of t and x2 of t are there. So orthogonality condition is nothing but integral t1 t to x1 of t into x2 of t dt equal to 0, or x2 of t into x1 of t dt is equal to 0. Similarly, in the same manner, we can represent the orthogonality in complex signals as these two conditions. These are integral t1 to t2 x1 of t x2 star t dt is equal to 0, or integral t1 to t2 x1 star t into x2 of t dt is equal to 0. With this, we can end this session. In the next class, we will discuss about the remaining topics. Okay, thank you.